If you have your Bible, turn with me to Mark chapter 5, as Chuck made mention here this morning, as we will be Mark chapter 4, my mistake. I knew it was in Mark someplace. As it opens up here, it says, "And he began again to teach by the seaside, and there was gathered unto him a great multitude. So he entered in a ship, and he sat in the sea, and the whole multitude was by the sea." Of course, as we saw last week, they had moved the boat away from the seashore, as so many people had come to see and to hear about Jesus. And they came all the way from Syria, from Tyre, from Transjordan, all the way up in the area from Jerusalem. They all came. They're flocking to hear what Jesus would do. Maybe the word had gone out where Jesus healed that one woman who touched the hem of his garment. Some way or another, the excitement of his teaching, the excitement of his healing has gone through all the land, and they were flocking to Jesus. In verse 2, "And he taught them many things by parables, and said unto him, in his doctrine." His doctrine is the doctrine, the teachings of Jesus. And so what we're to be looking at as the things that the Lord thought was important for us as his disciples to know. And when he says that word parables, and of course we're in the parables of the kingdom of God. It starts off in Matthew's account in Matthew chapter 13. So we're looking at the parables concerning the kingdom of God. And when you break down parables, simply you get that word para at the beginning, means alongside. And so what we're to be doing is, as Jesus is laying down a truth, he's trying to teach everybody about a truth that he's trying to communicate, he brings these stories alongside to illustrate and really to bring them home. And so that's what parables are doing for us here today, is to help us to understand. And he tells us, "Hearken, otherwise pay attention. Behold, there went out a sower to sow." And of course, the audience that he was speaking to, what were they made up of? They were farmers. They were fishermen. And so he was finding something that was very familiar to everybody as he was sharing this story with them. And back then, if you lived in the village, if you lived in a city full time, during the summertime, of course, it was a time to plant your vegetables, much like us. We like to think that we're farmers, too. But they would go out into the field, and they would put up some type of lean tube or, you know, little tent where they could stay probably during the weekend so they could, you know, plant their seeds, weed their gardens and everything else, and they would go back in the village. And so everybody had some sort of understanding of either fishing or agricultural in a sense. In verse 4, "And it came to pass now, as he sowed, some by fell upon the wayside, and the fowls of the air came and devoured it up. Some fell upon the stony ground, which had not much earth, and immediately it sprung up, because it had no depth of earth." And of course, as we know this parable, he's going to give us four different types of soil or places that the seed fell on. The first one, as the sower went, they would have the seeds in the basket, and they would throw it out. They didn't have big tractors that would plant their seeds back then. You were the tractor. And so as it went out, it fell upon, like, the sidewalk, the path, the hard place. There was no place for it really to, you know, germinate. But then he says that there by the rocky place, and especially if you go over to Israel around Bethlehem and the southern part, there is so many rocks. And, you know, if you go out to Hemet or some of Joshua Tree in that area, in our area, you see all the rocks. But within the rocks are these little crevices where some dirt has set in there. Enough dirt, when a seed would drop in there, it could spring up, it could grow, you know, in that little bit of dirt. And that's what he said. Some of the seeds fell upon the path, some fell upon the rocky area per se. And tells us in verse 6, "But when the sun was up, it was scorched because it had no root. It withered away. And some fell upon the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no fruit." And others fell upon the ground, and it did yield fruits, and it sprang up and increased, and it brought forth some 30, some 60, and some 100. And he said unto them, he that has an ear to hear, let him hear, and let him hear. And this is a phrase that Jesus uses quite often. He's given us an invitation for really to listen to what the Spirit is saying, what God is saying to us. And of course, we all got ears, but a lot of us are spiritually dull to the things of God. And really what he's saying is that we should be opening up our spiritual ear to hear the things that the Spirit would say to us in this. In verse 10, he says, and when he was alone, and that were about him were 12, and he asked him the parable. And he said unto you it is given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God, but unto them that are without, all these things are done in parables. Otherwise, there are those here that will hear these parables, but they don't understand because these things are spiritually discerned. They don't have an understanding of this. That seeing they may see and not perceive, in verse 12, and hearing they may hear and not understand, lest at any time they should be converted and their sins should be forgiven them. Otherwise they could see it, but they don't perceive it. You know, I really believe what he's saying here too. The God of this world has blinded their eyes. Even though they could see it, they won't perceive it. They won't understand it. You ever been with somebody, and I know in the times past, where I talk about various things in the kingdom of God, and they get this blank look on their face. I could lay out the marvelous prophecies concerning the Messiah. We could go back and look at the tremendous prophecy of Daniel chapter 9 and lay it out without a doubt. The day, the hour when Jesus Christ came gloriously there on Palm Sunday. And as you lay it out, I get all excited anytime I talk about that and study it. But they'll look at you like, what are you talking about? They won't get it because the God of this world has blinded their eye. It's almost like that idea when in the Old Testament, when Pharaoh harden his heart against the things of God. Remember that story? It said that God hardened his heart. It was the fact that really what it means that God strengthened his heart in the position that he had already had taken. And it's the God of this world has blinded them. And he says, even if they see these things, they're not going to hear it. They're not going to come to the repentance because their mind is made up. You know, when you run across people like that, sometimes I want to give up on them, but I'm so glad that God didn't give up on me. And we don't know that who those people are. They might be just on the verge of making their decision for Jesus Christ. And then he said unto them in verse 13, he's speaking to his disciples, know ye not this parable? And know then will you how then will you know all parables? If you don't understand this, you're not going to understand the rest of the things that I have to say to you. In other words, more or less, he's telling about the parables that for they need to understand. In verse 14, he says, the sower soweth the word. The sower sows the word. When Jesus starts giving you a definition of the parable, we need to understand what he's doing here. What we see here in a technical sense when you're studying the Bible, it's called expositional constancy. In the parables, I find it's very interesting when Jesus uses something in symbolic language like the seed, and then we get the understanding what it is. All the way through the parables, it means the same thing. Every time we hear about a seed, it's the word of God. Even later on, we'll be talking about the birds here, how the birds represent something that's evil. And so as we go through even the story of the mustard seed, how the birds landed in the shade of it, it's just, we have to, what's the meaning of that? Well, we go back and understand it represents evil. And so that's what's consistent through the parables as you study in them. In verse 15, he says, these are they by the wayside, where the word is sown, but when they have heard it, Satan comes immediately and taketh away the word that was sown in his heart. What did they take? It took the word of God. He's referring back to verse 4, where the seed that went upon the, just upon the path, right upon the roadway, the birds, you could see them. Oh, there's a bunch of seeds there on the ground. They would flock down and they would start eating that food right away, and they would pluck it right out of their heart. You know, when I look at this verse, of course, and over the years I've had the privilege to be among some very large crusades. For the Billy Graham Crusades out at the Rose Bowl, of course, the beginning of the Harvest Crusades out at Pacific Amphitheater. In fact, pray for Greg as he's doing a venture online right now this weekend for the Harvest. And then Franklin Graham Crusades. And, you know, people would be so critical of the Crusades because they would say, well, 10,000 people went forward. Well, not everybody sticks, they would say. Not everybody remains. And it would be so critical, the fact that, you know, you don't must not have a good enough discipleship program going on, you know, because not everybody stays. Well, Jesus said this would happen. And actually, if you look at these parables, you know, if you ended up, if there's four of them, only 25% of them fall upon good soil, if 10,000 go forward, we should rejoice that, Lord willing, there'll be 2,500 great disciples moving forward through it. You know, if you just look at it that way, we should, rather than criticizing mass evangelism, we should rejoice over one person that gets saved, one person that comes to know the Lord. Would to God that many more people would come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. He says that Satan has a way about him. Because if he could pluck the word of God out of somebody's heart right away, and that's his purpose, is to snatch them out of their heart. Be in prayer for always, I believe, for Christians, for young believers, for those who come to know Jesus Christ, that God would protect them from the attacks of the enemy. He has something that he wants to do, you know, is to pluck it out of their hearts. And verse 16, and these are they like which were sown in stony ground, who when they have heard the word, immediately receive it with gladness. Otherwise, you can see them, they almost bouncing around with glee and joy. You know, we have, you know, I know the forgiveness of God, and they're so excited about the things. But then he tells us about these people in verse 17, and have no root in themselves, so endure it but for a time. Afterwards, when affliction or persecution arises, notice what it says, for the word's sake. Not for weirdness, not for the weird things sometimes Christians parade themselves out doing, but for the gospel's sake, for the truth's sake. Immediately, they're offended. No depth, no root, what Jesus is saying. They haven't grown in the things of God. Because, you know, we'll talk a little bit more about this. You know what happens when you start growing it, as the seed starts growing? You know what actually grows? It's faith. It's our faith in him that will carry us through our trials and tribulations of life. There's a promise in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, it doesn't particularly excite me. It says, they that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer what? Persecution. And so really, when trials and persecution comes, they quit so easily. Maybe they go amongst their co-workers, or in my younger days we would go back to high school or college or amongst family members. Could be, so, you know, what do you mean you went to church? What are you doing going to church? So discouraging. And so when they come, whatever persecution they came, even though they started off so strong, they back off of it, because it says there's no root. They haven't grown. Nothing to stabilize them through the trials. Verse 18, it says, and these are they which are sown among thorns, such as hear the word. You know, this is the one that concerns me the most. Christians who seemed to come and hear and receive and seemed to stand for a while, and they really have a time of development, but they come to a place where their spiritual state goes backwards, where they stop growing. Paul would liken them and calls them babes in Christ. Have you ever heard that phrase in the scripture, babes in Christ, where they haven't really matured? They're still hanging on to the things of this world. They're still hanging on to their carnal, sinful nature. They could go to church every Sunday night, midweek service, and you know, even be within the choir, but they haven't matured at all. They haven't gone forward in their life because they're still living for this world all the rest of the time unless they're in church. They want a polished message. They want to be entertained. They want their flesh to be entertained. So you'll find a lot of times these people hopping from church to church to church. They don't want to deal with the real issues of their life, to die to their flesh. You know, other things, as he tells us, well, let's look at what he tells us that these thorns are. What's going to trip up these people? He says, first of all, in verse 19, the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, the lust of the things entering in. It tells us it has a direct effect. It tells us that it choked the word and it became what? Unfruitful. The cares of this world. He doesn't define what it is. We could get so caught up in the things, the social issues that are around us, and believe me, we have a lot going on right now. They want us to be so concerned where it gets overwhelming our life. I'm not saying we shouldn't be concerned, but isn't it an issue of priority within our life that he's talking about? Jesus says, seek ye what? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and that we keep our love relationship with him first. The cares of our world could choke up our love relationship with Jesus Christ, and before we know it, we're just going to church. And we're no longer effective for the kingdom of God. I'm very much a political person. I'm really concerned about this coming election. And we're going to be talking more about it as we get closer and praying each week for the politics. But I want to keep my priority right, that my relationship with Jesus Christ comes first. That ultimately God's in control. The cares of the world could become within relationships. That you've, oh my goodness, not me, because I have a great relationship with my wife, but I know people who've had terrible relationships going on where it overwhelms their life so much, where they once were so strong in Jesus Christ, where their problems and the cares of this world has overtook them, and they're no longer having Jesus first in their life when they're in love with Jesus. We used to sing a song, I got Jesus and that's enough. And they're no longer able to sing that song, I got Jesus and that's enough. The cares of the world, you can figure out what it means to your own life. Our things become so important to you that Jesus has taken a back seat. If that ever happens, well, let's take a look at the other two. He talks about the deceitfulness of riches. The deceitfulness of riches. You know, to think that the more money I put in my bank, the happier I'm going to be. We've all been that way, on that road. It doesn't work that way, does it? Because there's always somebody that wants to take that money away. There's always somebody that wants us to tap into our money. You know, it's best that, as we'll be talking about tonight, about those who would seek after riches. And, you know, Jesus talked about that, how we should put our treasure where? Put our treasure in heaven, where moth and different things can't corrupt it. But the deceitfulness of riches is that idea that it's going to make me happy. It's going to make me fulfilled. I'm going to find everything that I want. And we end up living for the riches rather than living for who? Living for Jesus. And this is what he's talking about, how the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust, notice the lust for other things, enter into your heart. I got to have. You know, and that's what he's talking about, that thrive, that pulse that's inside of you. He says, once I get that I will be happy. And I've told you this story before, and I'll tell you again. As a young man, I thought the coolest thing I could ever do, and it's the only time I ever did, I bought a brand new truck. The only brand new vehicle we've ever had. It was a Toyota truck, and it was a blue, similar to the truck I'm driving right now. I thought it was the prettiest thing, and I just couldn't wait to get it. And that's all I could think about. That's all my life was all about, was that truck. I bought it over at that time with Santa Ana. Toyota was off of Warner. Now it's something else. I think it's a school over there they no longer had. I had a 63 Volkswagen van. I was taking it over to trade in that Volkswagen van. And they said, well, okay, well, we worked a deal out. Why don't you drive it into our driveway? And as I was making a left into their driveway off of Warner, the housing of the motor mounts broke, and the engine dropped on the road. I said, oh, thank you. And they looked at me, well, we already made the deal. The truck's yours. So I'm thinking, all right, everything's great. Everything's marvelous. Look at my beautiful truck. And I said, there's a little dust down on that. And I was living over Tustin over there at that time. And right there, there's a spray wash right by Tustin High School. And I get over to Tustin High School, and I'm not the high school, over to the spray wash and pull my truck in. And I think it was 2 quarters at that time. I put it in the slot machine. And all of a sudden, I heard that thing fired up. The thing fired up, and I heard the water going, ch-ch-ch-ch. And I saw that hose come pulling out of that harness, and it went flipping up in the air, and that thing landed right on the hood of my truck. And I saw these two big dimples. All I'd driven was from the parking lot to this car wash right in the center of my truck. And I looked at it, and at first I was crushed. And I said, thank you, Jesus. I never had it repaired, because it reminded me of priority. It reminded me it's not about these things. It's not about what we can hold on to. It's about Jesus Christ. Francis Schaeffer once told us, he says, how then shall a man live? He says, if you want to look at all your possessions, the things that you live, the things that you think so are important to you, go to the city dump. Take a look at those beautiful refrigerators and TVs that we thought were so important. See what they look like a few years later. Go visit the city dumps. And I thought that was pretty wise. And he tells us if we go after these things, it chokes the word, and God's word becomes unfruitful in his life. The seed that's now within our hearts, that's bringing forth faith. And that faith brings forth what? It brings forth fruit within our life. As it tells us in John 15, that God's desire is that we bear much fruit. And because in bearing much fruit, John tells us that our Father is much glorified. But the cares of the world will choke us off. If we find ourselves out of control in any of these issues, we have to listen to what Jesus said to the church in the book of Revelation as he was walking to the church through the candlesticks. And he said, told them, what did he tell them? He says, if you got your life out of priority, if you found yourself loving other things, he says, return to your first love. Repent and do the first works all over again. Come back to the place where you're in love with Jesus. Here's verse 20. He says, these are they which are sown upon good ground, such as hear the word of God, and then not just hear it, but receive it. And it brings forth fruit at some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100. This idea of receiving God's word is an act of your will. It's a choice that I'm going to believe God's word, and I'm going to treasure it within my heart. The net result, it's going to bring forth fruit within your life. It can't help but do it. You plant a seed in the ground. Wasn't very long, the sun hits it. You water it a little bit. And, unbelievable magic. Something grows. It grows. The formula works with the Word of God, that we need to do this. We need to allow God's word to sink deep within our hearts, then treasure and believe the things that God says. The author of the book of Hebrews says that we should lay aside the first principles of the doctrine of Christ, the repentance of dead works, the laying hands of the baptism in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, let us go on to maturity. Otherwise, when we receive the word of God, let's grow. Paul tells us the purpose of the gifting of ministers. He gave some apostles, others prophets, others evangelists, and pastor teachers, which was for the perfecting of the saints, to bring them into maturity. That's what he said, to bring them where they would grow. And as he tells us the way that we grow, that we might be the complete man in Christ Jesus. So the word of God, the seed that's planted within our hearts, Jesus is saying, as you receive the word of God within your heart, then that produces faith. Because as the Bible tells us, this faith comes from hearing and hearing the word of God. And that faith then will bring forth fruit of the Holy Spirit within your life. In verse 21, and he said unto them, and to his disciples, is a candle brought to be put underneath a bushel or under a bed and not set on a candlestick? Of course, the purpose of light, the purpose of Jesus in our life is that we would shine to bring light to other people. Matthew chapter 5 talks about the same thing in verse 14 and 15. He says, you are the light of the world. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, man doesn't take and put candle under a bushel, but a candlestick, that it might bring light to all that are in the house. The word of God, in that effect, Jesus is telling us in verse 21, as your life is going to bring forth fruit, you're going to be a witness. You're going to affect other people because you're going to be radiate light to them. You know, you ever notice when some people don't want to be around you? Some of your old friends, some of your old associates. It's not that, you know, the clothes you're wearing are bad, or maybe, you know, your personality, that part hasn't changed. But they sense something different about you. It's the light of God living inside of you. They can see it in your eyes, and that repels them from you, not necessarily want to be around you. But yet Jesus says that's the net effect, that we're going to be the light of the world because Jesus is the light of the world. In verse 22, he tells us, for there is nothing hid which that should not be manifested or else revealed, neither was anything kept secret, but it should be come abroad. Remember when Jesus addressed the churches in Revelation, to each of them he said, I know thy works. He said, I know every one of you. I know your thoughts. I know everything that you're doing. And that to me, in a sense, is a refreshing. In this sense, he knows me and he still loves me. And he's very gracious to me. And he knows you. If any man has an ear, let him hear. Otherwise, he's repeating this. If you have an ear, listen to what I'm saying. And as you go home this day, and we're only spending a short 30 minutes going over these verses, I would encourage you to meditate and think about what Jesus is saying to this church, to his disciples, because that's you. And I would encourage you to be praying that the word of God would really sink deep within your heart, that you would allow it to change. And then he said unto them, take heed what you hear. With what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you. Unto you that hear shall more be given. For he that hath, to him it shall be given. And he that have not, from him it shall be taken, even that which he had. And he says, so you have ears to hear, hear. Now, then he goes on, he says, be careful what you hear. Be careful what comes into your mind and what's filtered in. There's a lot of people say, they would like to say to you, I like to be open-minded. Shouldn't you be open-minded about everything? Oh, boy, you know, there's people who are looking for you. That's you. Because they want to fill you with their doctrine, their philosophies, their things that they believe is right. Jesus said, be careful what you mete out. Otherwise, be careful of the things that you take into your mind and the things that you ponder that it's contrary to the Word of God, that we allow the Word of God to direct us and to lead us. And he said, so the kingdom of God, as if a man should cast seed into the ground. Now he's talking about the kingdom of God, as we saw earlier. He says, the kingdom of God is like a man who casts seed into the ground and should sleep and rise night and day, and the seed should spring and grow up, and he knoweth not how. And he said, otherwise the process, he says, all I did was put the seed in the ground and went to bed, and up it came, and the seed should spring and grow up, he knoweth not. The Word of God is planted in a miraculous way that it brings to pass transformation and change in people's life, is what Jesus is saying here. Just day by day. That's how it happens. The growth is slow, day by day by day. We're changed from glory to glory by the glory each day as we seek Him out. As we receive God's Word, it's taken place. And I believe the basic whole principle of the ministry of Agape Chapel is found right here. It's just the teaching of God's Word, the effect of God's Word that it has on people's life. As you hear the Word of God, be it here, if you go to hear Pastor Odin, or you listen to Pastor Chuck during the week, and God willing, that you open up your Bible and read it for yourself, your life will be changed day by day by day. That's what Jesus is saying. As you receive the Word of God, it's going to produce faith within your life. It's going to change you. It's going to cause you to grow. I pray that this week, that all of us will take the Word of God serious. We're living in troubling times. We're living in very momentous times. I have behind us our banner that Chris, Bill, and I did at the beginning some 6 years ago when we started a program called Answers for Today. And the main thrust of it is to tell people the answers of what's going on in our world this day, as we just got done talking about the Middle East peace situation, and we believe as being a template for the second coming, when after we get raptured for the church by Jesus Christ, there, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, what's going to happen? How's the Antichrist going to bring peace within this land? Maybe we might have a template for it to happen. And so we believe that the Bible brings answers not only for today, but for tomorrow. I hope that you do too, as you hang on to God's Word. When we go to the Lord in prayer.